Good to see each of you with us this morning. I ask you to open your Bibles to Amos in the Old Testament. Amos in chapter 8, and we'll be there in just a few moments. Glad to see everyone who is in this building, and I know the others are in the other building. They're not quite as comfortable as we are in here. There's an air conditioner problem over there, and so as they bear through the sweat, we're glad to have them as well, thinking with us upon spiritual things. We've got those who are visiting. The Longs, I notice, are visiting. We're so glad to have them. That's always an unexpected pleasure to see them. And they brought a future Long along with them, Emma, who is here. We're glad to have her as well. In Amos chapter 8, there's a situation that is brought up where the land of Israel has come to its end. You look and you see throughout Israelite history what God intended. He had promised Abraham to bring his descendants into the land. He had defined that land and he had caused them to come in and have conquest, to be able to overtake it and go into that place. They were led by God and by judges who spoke for God. And then they asked for a king to lead them instead. God gave them one after their own desire, like Saul, and he was one who went away from God. God took the kingdom away from him and gave it to David and his descendants from that time on to be the kings that would be after his order. Not long after that, you have the death of Solomon that comes along next and the division of the kingdom that took place under Rehoboam and Jeroboam. Never again did Israel go back to the true worship of God the way that they should. The southern kingdom of Judah followed and then went away and followed and went away, more going away than following. But Israel never did come back to fully be those who would be observant of the law of God. Instead, it kind of wasted away and went from them. God would try to bring them back through times of persecution, or through times of famine or peril or all kinds of things, to try to get them to think about it more. But they did not. They kept going on and on and on. And what you see by the time you come to the book of Amos is the last chapter of the story. Here you come to a time when everything seems to be all right as far as Israel was looking at. Indeed, from everything that we see in the books of history, it seems that Israel is at a time of greater prosperity than is Judah at this particular point. They were ones who Amos described as living in houses that were summer houses that they might have, not just having one, but two, an extreme privilege that was taking place there among some. He pointed out their couches were those that were of silk and inlaid with ivory. Expensive. It was something that was a luxury that was there. And as they looked at all of this, the people thought, well, everything is going well. So God talks to Amos at this time. And while they're looking at the summer fruit that is there, he's pointing out to them something is changing. As they lived at this time, there was a time in which you were a bit by bit seeing problems brought up. In most countries, before there is a downfall of that country, there's a division that exists among people. A division of classes, of politics, of all kinds of things like that. And the result is that over time, what you see develop is that there are two countries. There's one that is this way and there's one that's diametrically opposed. And that's what leads ultimately to a downfall. While they looked before them at the summer fruit, God was trying to get Israel through Amos to concentrate on what's coming. What's coming is not that summer fruit that you see before you. What's coming is a famine, but a famine far worse than anything we had in the Dust Bowl or the Great Depression or anything else. It's a famine that is spiritual in its nature. In Amos chapter 8 and in verse 1, the statement is made, Thus the Lord God showed me, behold, a basket of summer fruit. And he said, Amos, what do you see? So I set a basket of summer fruit. Then the Lord said to me, the end has come upon my people Israel. I will not pass by them anymore. And the song of the temple shall be wailing in that day, says the Lord God. Many dead bodies everywhere, they shall be thrown out in silence. Hear this, you who swallow up the needy and make the poor of the land fail, saying, when will the new moon be passed that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath that we may trade wheat, making the ephah small and the shekel large, falsifying the scales by deceit, that we may buy the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and even sell the bad wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their works. Shall the land not tremble for this? Everyone mourn who dwells in it? All of it shall swell like the river, heave and subside like the river of Egypt. And it shall come to pass in that day, says the Lord, that I will make the sun go down at noon, and I will darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your feasts into mourning and all your songs into lamentation. I will bring sackcloth on every waist, and boldness on every head. I will make it like mourning for an only son, and its end like a bitter day. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord God, that I will send a famine in the land, or on the land. Not a famine of bread, nor thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea, and from north to east they shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but shall not find it. You know, time and again through Israel's history, in both the United Kingdom and the division, you could see this kind of problem existing. The problem came when they left the word of God. Now, were there other problems that were there that were physical in nature? Yes, famines. There were pestilence. There were all kinds of things that happened when they would do evil, God trying to bring them back. But the central point of the problem was those physical things came upon them because of the problems that they were having spiritually. And God was trying to get their spiritual awareness to be open, to understand that they were not following God's will. They had left it by the way. At times it was put in the wall. And they no longer had a copy of the law to even read. They didn't know what it said. And as a result of that, they would fall away. The law would be found. They would read it. They would repent. They would wail because they understood, we've not been doing the will of God. But that didn't solve the problem for very long because the word was put away again. And the result was the apostasy came surely and fully. Now, how'd you get from the one point to the other? How'd it go from feast to famine? They're looking at it, everything's going great. But how did we get from that point to the point where now there's a famine in the land of the Word of God and the judgment is sure that is coming upon them? Let me suggest to you the first thing was that they were looking at the material world. They had focused on material things. When you look over in Luke chapter 21, Jesus is talking to the people here of Jerusalem. And the fact is that Jerusalem was about to be destroyed. He's talking about that destruction that came upon them in about the year AD 70. It came upon them because that had been foretold by God. As they continued to go away from Him, He would forever put away Israel as a special people. They would no longer have a covenant relationship with Him. Notice the time in which this is happening. And what Jesus says is behind some of that. He says, but take heed to yourselves, lest your heart be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and cares of this life, and that day come upon you unexpectedly. When our focus is on physical things, The cares of this life, it drowns out the spiritual concern. It increases a carelessness that is there with the will of God and looking at the Word of God. Because what's being looked at is everything and how it's going right now physically in this world. When you have that kind of a problem, there's another one that's coming. And that is the cares, the concerns, the thought is on the physical, and the spiritual is going to be starved out point by point. Look over in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15. I think all of us are familiar with the words of this. The Apostle John says, "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." There the two are put in contrast. What is the world? The world isn't just talking about the physical universe. It's talking about that which is characteristic of the universe, of physical things. That there's not a spiritual health behind them. They're only going along in the way that seeks what's best for them physically. He says, now don't love this present age. Don't love this world. Don't love the things that characterize people who have no spiritual concern. Why? Because that's the antithesis of the Father. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. There's your dichotomy. It's one way or the other. You don't have people who have their focus and their concern and their main priority on the things of the world, and yet on the other side of that, they're perfectly spiritually minded. That doesn't happen. There's a priority that has to be there. Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of heaven and His righteousness. That's the priority that has to exist. If that doesn't come above all else and order all else, then we've got a problem. There's a direction that is going that is away from God. In Colossians chapter 3, therefore, the Apostle Paul gives this admonition. He says, if then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Folks, that wasn't just a problem for Israel of old. That wasn't just a problem for people who were there in the first century who came more and more to doing away with the gospel and looking at the things that surrounded them with the height of abuse of the Roman Empire. That happens today. And we need to understand the fact that if we're going to be as God would have us to be, and help with regard to the going away of God's people that happens from time to time, it's going to have to be that we set our mind on things that are above. That has to be the focus. That has to be the concern that's there. Not all of these things taking place in this present life. Yes, they happen. Do we need to take care of them? Absolutely we do. But our focus has to stay on God and His will. Our absolute obsession has to be on the cause of Christ and causing it to be increased in all that we do. But notice they went from feast to famine not only because their thoughts were on the material world, the things of this physical realm, but they also went that way because the people's desire was for sinful things. Did you notice what it said back in Amos 8? What they were wanting is they were wanting this time of the new moon to be passed. Why? They had to sacrifice then. But they could go out and sell and get richer if they would just be ones who passed that time. They wanted the Sabbath to pass. Why? So that they could do what they needed to do to get more money and to be involved in more things. But it wasn't just that there was a material focus. Look what else it says. And that is the point of doing this in verse 5, making the ephah small and the shekel large, falsifying the scales by deceit. Now, what was happening? They were being dishonest. It wasn't just a physical, worldly prospect. When you keep your thoughts on physical things all the time, the sinful things come in. Why? You remember what we just quoted a minute ago in 1 John chapter 2? love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world is what? The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the vainglory of life. It's not of the Father. That's of the world. Sinful matters come into our life when we think about those things of this present world. And it gets to have our priority. That's what was taking place here. Amos goes on to notice the fact that they bought those who were poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals. In other words, they abused those. While some were getting more and more, others were getting less and less, and they didn't care about it at all. Even to the point of what? That last phrase in verse 6. Even selling the bad wheat. In other words, everything that had gone bad, that was no longer fit to eat, that's what they had sell to others out there and pass it off as if it was good. That's wrong. That's lying. That's a sense of a lack of concern and love and care for others. How'd it get there? They put the focus on the physical things. That was what they were concerned about, and therefore, anything that enriched them or made them better, hey, that's great. They would do it even when it's wrong. The sinful things then became the result of that. When you look at Isaiah chapter 5, this point is made repeatedly, really, all through Isaiah 5. The whole chapter is good to read with respect to this and pointing out the problems that were present in Judah. But in verse 13, it says, "Therefore my peoples," God speaking, "therefore my people have gone into captivity, because they have no knowledge. Their honorable men are famished, and their multitude dried up with thirst." Here Isaiah is referring to, in his time, about 721 B.C., you had had the northern kingdom of Israel. They had gone into captivity of Assyria. But his warning and his work is with those down in Judah. He's before the king there, Hezekiah, and causing him to understand and to do what is right. He says, now here's what happened to Israel. Look at it. Drop down, if you will, to about verse 18 and notice the point. "Woe to those who draw iniquity with cords of vanity and sin as if with a cart rope, that say, let me make speed and hasten his work, that we may see it, and let the counsel of the Holy One of Israel draw near and come, that we may know it. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those who are wise in their own sight and prudent in their own sight." You see the idea that's being there? Here are people, he says, you're being those who look at injustice and ungodliness and sin, and that's your desire, and you even call it good. You've changed the terms altogether. And what happens in verse 22 and following is he talks about those who have gone after wine, the intoxicating drink that is there, and how that's not looked as that anything bad anymore. That's looked at as something that's a good thing to do. Anybody who wouldn't do that's crazy. Then you've got the other things that he names of sin that they fell into. Why did they do that? They first put their concentration on physical things. Then with those physical things, they asked, what's going to make life just in this world? No mention of God. We've forgotten about him. What's going to make that better? What's going to make that easier for us? And they went after sin time and time again. When you look over in Psalm 52, that's pointed out as something that takes place with the wicked. Here the wicked are described, and he says, you love evil more than good, lying rather than speaking righteousness. The idea of it, that's your desire. Well, that's what had happened in Isaiah's time and in Amos' time. They loved those things of evil, and they desired them. Why? They were thinking on things that were physical. As a result of that, the love of the world got into them. Notice what we see over in 2 Thessalonians. Because the same point is made with regard to those who will fall away in this time. Who will fall away during the last days, that time that began with the beginning of the gospel on the day of Pentecost, and will end at the second coming of Jesus Christ. He says the coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, now notice this, because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. They didn't receive a love of the truth. What kind of love or pleasure or delight did they have? Verse 11. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but what? But had pleasure in unrighteousness. That's where their desire is. Folks, when you look around and you see what happens to those who drift off with the Word of God, this is exactly the pattern that takes place. First, there is a concentration on the physical things of this world. Bit by bit, God in His cause gets squeezed out. Then the values of that world seep in, and the desires for things that are sinful in their very nature. I look at our country today, and I see that happening. I know some look at older preachers when they get up and they give warnings, say, there that old man goes again. He's negative. No, that's not the point. Let me tell you something. I think the only people that can help in that process are the people of God if, and only if, they keep their focus on spiritual things and have a desire for the things of God and a hatred of sin. That's what David had when he pointed out, I hate that evil. And we need to learn to have that kind of disgust and contempt for the things of Satan as well and a yearning for the things of righteousness. Now, how's that happen? How that happens is the opposite of how it was about to happen with Israel. When they left off the love of spiritual things and put it on the physical world and loved the sin, then what happened? They left off the hearing of God's word and it faded away. There's a passage that was taken as really the text for the study that we had for some time on A Remnant Shall Return, the Waldron's book. And it's a passage that sums up in 2 Chronicles 36 the very idea of what had happened through Old Testament history and why it was that they ultimately were destroyed. It says, and the Lord God of their fathers sent warnings to them by His messengers, rising up early and sending them, because He had compassion on His people and on His dwelling place. But they mocked the messengers of God, despised His words, and scoffed at His prophets until the wrath of the Lord arose against His people. Now notice this. Till there was no remedy. Until there was no remedy. It was too far gone. That's the same point that 2 Thessalonians had made about people who act like Satan and they love the things of the sin and have no love of the truth. They discard it. They'll believe a lie. Why? Because they've left off the hearing of the Word. What does the Word do? In Hebrews chapter 4, you remember the statement of the Hebrew writer? That the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing of soul and spirit, of joint and marrow, and quick to what? Quick to discern the thoughts and the intents of the heart. That's what it does. God's Word is meant for the true heart, the mind, the will of the individual to do surgery on that, to open it up and let it be seen. There's a blockage much worse than any artery. It's a blockage of God's Word coming into the heart and soul and mind of the individual Christian, which will cause him to spiritually come to death. That word needs to be listened to. And when it's cut off, and it will not be listened to anymore, there is no remedy. What do we need to do? We need to understand, like Hosea chapter 4 and verse 6 points out, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I also will reject you from being priests for me. Because you have forgotten the law of your God, I also will forget your children." Most of you know I went to a Baptist seminary for graduate work. And when I did, I saw a bunch of things that I would not have believed otherwise. And in the end, by a negative sense, it ended up helping me. When I go to a class and they would talk about the theology of a class, go in there, they didn't mention what the passage said. That isn't the point. They might get a phrase out of there and we'd talk for about an hour on that phrase that was there, totally devoid from any context. At one point we talked about from the book of Hebrews, the Sabbath rest that God had given. You know what we got out of that? What was gotten out of that is we need to cancel our services on Sunday and Wednesday during the summer because, you know, that's just a drag. We ought to get out there and go vacation and be at the lake and do all of these other things and be around God in nature. I don't find that in my Bible, do you? How'd that get there? That got there because the concentration was not on the Word of God. And here were people who had no knowledge of the Word of God. And what happened? The end of it was they were brought to destruction with innovation after innovation after innovation, which is not authorized by the book of God. When you look at Mark chapter 7, you see the same thing happening of the Jews in the time of Jesus. Judaism had for about four centuries by this time been involved in not taking what the Old Testament law said as the director, but taking rabbinical traditions. In other words, the Mishnah, the idea of what the rabbis said, the ultimate bringing about of the Talmud, the Talmudic law that had these rabbinical traditions put into legal form to tell them what they ought to do. Judaism today doesn't look back to the Old Testament to see what they ought to do. They would laugh at the idea of that, and I'm talking about even Orthodox. What they do is they look back at their traditions, which have replaced the will of God. Now notice what Jesus said in showing why that happens. He says, "For laying aside," what? "The commandment of God, you hold," what? "The tradition of men, the washing of pitchers, the cups, and many other such things you do." He said to them, "All too well, you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your traditions." There's how it happens. How it happens is the commandments are first laid aside. Did you see that, verse 8? That's what happened. You lay those aside. You don't put your focus on them. Then what happens next? What happens next is, he says, you take up your traditions. You put your focus there. Now what happens? Verse 9 points out very clearly, doesn't it? You reject the commandments. The commandment of God as it's given is looked at somehow as a point of disdain. As a point of that which is ugly and what we ought not to do, even called evil many times. When we look at things that have taken place around us, and sadly I must admit a great number of my own brethren who have departed from the faith, the idea is to accept and tolerate immorality like homosexuality or like divorce and remarriage or the drinking of intoxicating beverages. All of this is looked at. We're more broad-minded. We're not like those narrow, hypocritical, pharisaical people who always thump their Bible. Let me tell you something. The Pharisees did not thump their Bible. The Pharisee thumped his tradition, and he disregarded the Bible. And when people turn away from what God says and will no longer accept that, that is not some higher point of religiousness. That is a rejection of God Almighty. And it is a rejection of His will that will ultimately cause the destruction not only of their souls, but the souls of everyone who listens to that kind of thing. 1 Peter chapter 1 gives us the proper view of the Word and salvation. You can tell something of taking place of apostasy every time. This isn't something that you can see or not see from time to time. This is what happens every time. When people look at the Word of God and what it says as a burden, and look at salvation as something that is a lighter thing than the Word of God, it goes beyond the Word of God. It's a feeling that you have. Watch out. Because it's separated the two things that God by inspiration put together. In 1 Peter chapter 1 and in verse 22, since you have purified your souls, how? In obeying the truth through the Spirit. In sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart. Having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible through the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man is the flower of grass. The grass withers, the flower falls away, but the Word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the Word which by the gospel was preached to you. Folks, take hold of the gospel of Jesus Christ and do not let it go. That is how we come to salvation, through obeying that truth. When someone in some way tries to desecrate the idea of being strict in keeping the will of God, and surely that's just too big a burden to have, you remember something. What they're doing inherently is they're separating salvation from the Word, and that is false to the core. The Word of God is how we come to salvation in the Spirit. That is what the Spirit gave to let us know what is His will. He spoke, according to 1 Corinthians 2, those things that were of the Spirit in the very words of the Spirit. That's what the Word of God is. You can't say, I'm going to listen to the Spirit somehow in some feeling I have, but I'm not going to listen to the Word. That's just kind of heavy and burdensome. That's the point. And the famine coming when that idea is there. That famine where people are in a famine not for food or for drink, but for hearing the Word of God, and they're led only by their own feelings. When I warned about that, does that make you feel like that's just all negative? That somehow that's just some rantings of an old man? I hope, for the love of God, you don't see that as my words. You see it from the Word of God. Folks, what we live in today is a world that is exactly like that in principle. That more and more what defines what we ought to be is tolerant of everything that God calls evil and intolerant of everything God calls good. We live in a society that more and more is given to division. Poor and rich. Race divided. Various political divisions. And what's happening is the more that that takes place, the more there's a focus on the physical things and you go away from the spiritual things. Let me tell you how you can help in that. How you can help in that is not by being a member of the right party or for voting for the right guy. How you can do that is by taking up the Word of God and spreading the principles to everybody you have an opportunity to spread them to. Even among God's people, I see too many times the divisions that are taking place in social media and everything over everything that has nothing to do with the Word of God. It's been amazing to me to look around this country and see the divisions that have come by whether or not I wear a mask, or by whether or not I vote for this party or that party, or whether or not I have this or that or the other in a physical thing. Folks, the Word of God does not talk about that. And while I may need to think about those things in physical terms and do what's wise, I do. Wouldn't make fun of that for a minute. That is not what the kingdom of Christ is about. When we look and we have the idea that we can go out to something else other than the Word to bring us back to doing the will of God, we've made the same mistake that they have of old. There's a famine of hearing the Word of God. Instead of the I thinks, I feel, and what's there as far as I'm concerned, there needs to be again what saith the Lord. What does the Scripture speak? And if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. There's where salvation comes from. Salvation comes in and through the blood of Jesus Christ. But what did He give to show us that way to have His blood, His Word? He bought it with His own blood. Dare any of us have the idea that somehow we can let that go away and we're to a place where we're better off? We are not. And we never will be. God's people are being called to a way that is narrow indeed the more we live in a society around us. A society fracturing based upon the fact that principles of Scripture have been given up can only be reached by a revival of those principles of truth in the Bible. You may be here, be a teacher. Your job's good. Teaching young people, I don't diminish that for a moment. Or maybe you're involved in some other thing, medical care, whatever it might be, that's good. There's things needed there. Maybe it is that you've been told as one in the military, your place is to secure the security of this country. I'll honor you for your service, but let me tell you something. You cannot secure this country by military service. If God decides to bring this country down, there is no missile, tank, gun, or whatever that can save it. What you desperately need to do is not give up your calling in your physical life, but to exalt your spiritual calling and to tell others around you the things of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Folks, as people are fracturing and splintering over things that have nothing to do with God's Word, what's happening? What we're desperately on the edge of is a famine of hearing the Word of God. Go back to that. The summer fruit went away, and those desperate, starving mouths were there of famine. Why? Not because the tomatoes and the lettuce were all gone. It was because the Word of God had all gone. Let's get back and study our Bibles. Let's get back and understand the spiritual things that have to have our first concern, our obsession to do what the Lord says to do. Maybe here that you've never started that path. You've never obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you're ready this morning. Come as a believer, believing that Jesus is indeed the Christ, the Son of God, repenting of your sins, confessing your faith before men, and being buried with Christ in baptism. Everything's ready for you to do that this very morning if you need to do so. If you've done that, but you've wandered from the path, maybe you've gone back into the world and the concentration on the world, and that's where your mind has been. That's private in nature. Go to God where you are in prayer. Ask Him for forgiveness and make that commitment to not only have that sorrow for what's been there, but a true repentance that changes that mind, changes that will, and changes that action to do what God would have you to do in repenting and seeking His forgiveness in prayer. If it's public in nature that we can help you to come back to God, restore your life to Him the way that it ought to be, then we hope you'll let us. Won't you come while we stand and sing?